Going to come down. Let's all stand, move out in the aisles, and make one another welcome. Let's all remain standing as we join in and sing, "Are You Washed in the Blood?" verses 1, 3, and 4. wonderful singing. You can have a seat at this time. The feasters are coming to sing for us.
I don't know if I'm more stressed out about singing or figuring out which side I'm supposed to stand on. As we just spent that last song figuring out which thing, but it's always the same. I don't know. I'll be even asked. But, oh well, there we go. Swing and a miss, strike and win.
Come at any moment, folks. Just come examine it. It is a delight to have Brother Jeff with us today. Brother Jeff, you come, if you would. Take a pulpit here and preach what God has put upon your heart for us today.
Thank you, Pastor. Thank
you. If you would, if your Bibles this morning, turn to the book of Acts, in Acts chapter 8. Just a simple message this morning. We appreciate the opportunity to have to come and preach the Word of God to you. Appreciate the good singing today and the gospel in song already. I knew Coach Feaster was a good coach. I didn't know he could play a guitar and sing. Did a good job. I've never seen a coach run as good a practice as Coach Feaster did and get his players in shape. And I want to say I like that. I like it. I think it's important as a Christian to do our best, and even in all that we do, and even for the things of God and our testimony. But I appreciate the good job he did. Appreciate your pastor again and sticking by the stuff. As I said last time, it's good to see his family in church. And I appreciate seeing a pastor with his family in the house of God. That's a blessing, encouragement. Speaks well of the pastor, but I want to say you've been blessed as a family. With your parents and grandparents have been a blessing. And we appreciate the stand that's been taken through the years, been a help. Yes, it has cost me a lot. And I pray one day be worth it. But it does. One time I figured up, I said, now how much is this going to cost when all of these children get through Vandalia Christian School? And I near fainted. But anyway, my knees got a little wobbly, as somebody said. It was a lot. And it is a cost, but we trust that the Lord will bless it and use it for His honor and glory. And we do thank and are thankful for how the school and this church has helped our family and our church in many ways. Been there to support. You got a good group of men and women that teach here and have been a help. And want to be a help and a blessing as I can today. In the book of Acts, in chapter 8, we read, and as we come to this place, and as I said, a simple, just common, already we've heard the gospel. But Dr. Luke is the writer of this book, and he's known as the great physician. He's written two New Testament books, the book of Acts, and of course the gospel account, the book of Luke. In Luke chapter 2, you'll find a precious place, is there in the place that gives the account of the birth of our Savior. As a doctor and a physician, he was concerned and careful how he gave of the story of how Christ was born. And our children were born. I noticed our pediatrician, Dr. Amos, a Christian doctor, he wasn't in the room very long, but every time he come in, he would do something very simple. He put on his stethoscope, pull up their little cloth material, listen to their chest. He'd pick up their hands and look at their fingers, and he'd pick up their legs and look at their toes. He'd say, well, everything looks okay, and he'd walk out the door, and I said, my, I could be a doctor. Just something simple. But he was concerned, and in his evaluation, much different than you and I, he was very careful to pay attention to detail and to look at this little one. And so Luke is the great physician, or a beloved physician, we would say. He looks at the birth of Christ in chapter 2 in the book of Acts, and he gives a special account. In Acts chapter 2, he looks at another birth, and that's the birth of the church. Again, the day of Pentecost, when the church and a book of history and the book of Acts, we see where the church is born on the day of Pentecost. And we also notice that this book is a transitional book, and this is a book that tells us the history of the early church. There's some things that he emphasizes. As he emphasized in the book of Luke, he emphasizes what Christ did in his physical body, in his earthly ministry, as he came to seek and to save that which was lost. But in the book of Luke, he emphasizes what Christ is doing while he's in heaven in his body, the church. And this is recorded in historical matter, and these things that take place at the time the church is going through persecution. And I believe yet today in our life, the church will face more persecution. But in the midst of this, as men were scattered and people were scattered, the Christians were scattered, there were still those that were being saved through the preaching of the gospel. We learned some things about the early church in this book. We learned that they believed in the resurrection. 33 times, the central message of the church, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. They believed and preached in 26 times. Recorded sermons are given in the book of Acts. They believed in missions, and Acts is used as a missionary manual still today. The early church believed in the Holy Spirit, 56 times referred to. They believed in faith, of course, 55 times mentioned. And then the early church believed in prayer, 31 recorded prayers in the book of Acts. And they believed in witnessing, 60 times it was illustrated of the witness, the examples were given, what the early church did. And we don't pattern everything, of course, by this transitional book, but we do understand this is the history of the church. And this is how the history of the operation of the church is carried forth. I want us to look, if you would, in Acts chapter 8. I want to read just a few verses this morning. Verse 5. Then Philip went down to the city of Samaria and preached Christ unto them. And the people with one accord gave heed unto those things which Philip spake, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. For unclean spirits, crying with loud voice, came out of many that were possessed with them, and many taken with palsies, and that were lame and were healed. And there was great joy in that city. We find, if you would, drop down to verse 26. And the angel of the Lord spake unto Philip, saying, Arise and go toward the south unto the way going down from Jerusalem unto Gaza, which is desert. And he arose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopian eunuch of great authority under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who had the charge of all her treasure and had come to Jerusalem for to worship, was returning and sitting in his chariot, read Isaiah the prophet. And then the Spirit said unto Philip, Go near and join thyself to this chariot. And Philip ran thither to him and heard him read the prophet Isaiah and said, Understandest thou what thou readest? Verse 31, and he said, How can I accept some man should guide me? And he desired Philip that he would come up and sit with him. The place of the scripture which he read was this, He was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and like a lamb dumb before his shearer, so openeth he not his mouth. In his humiliation, his judgment was taken away, and who shall declare his generation, for his life is taken from the earth? And the eunuch answered Philip and said, I pray thee, of whom speaketh the prophet this, of himself or of some other man? Then Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him Jesus. And as they went on their way, they came unto a certain water. And the eunuch said, See, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? And Philip said, If thou believest, with all thine heart thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And he commanded the chariot to stand still. And they went down both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. When they were come up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord called away Philip, and the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. And I want us to go to the Lord in prayer. Father, today we come in Jesus' name. We're thankful for the blessings of this life. The health and strength you give us, allow us to come to your house today. And I pray to worship you in spirit and truth, but to honor you and obey you. We pray you forgive us of our sin, cleanse our heart and mind. Father, make us, Lord, to be what you'd have us to be. As we've already been reminded, Lord, keep us near to the cross. And let us never get over what you've done for us. We thank you today for the great gift of salvation, the gift of eternal life. And I pray if there be one that knows you not, Lord, within the sound of our voice today, that you'd speak to their heart by work of conviction from the Holy Spirit. Do a work in them and convict them of their sin and show them the need of repentance and belief before it's eternally too late. Lord, we thank you for what you've done for us. Help us to be found faithful. Lord, help us to humble ourselves before you. We ask and pray your blessings on the time. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want us today, as in simple thought today in these verses that we've read, and I realize there's nothing new that I could ever come and preach in this pulpit. I understand you've probably had some of the best preaching in this pulpit from across our land, and especially a pastor to be faithful to preach through the Word of God. But this today is a familiar place, yes, I know. But I never want to get over what God's done for me when He saved me from my sin.
I'm telling you today, it ought to be a place that we ought to always remember, but always rejoice within our heart what God has done when He saved us. I want us to first of all look today in the sermon, a preacher that is sin, or a preaching servant. This man that we read of was Philip. What has taken place, we read of Peter that began preaching in Acts chapter 2. But now Philip is again used of God to preach the word of God. Just this following chapter we find one is converted by the name of Saul, one greatly used to give us the New Testament in writing, that by the name of Paul. He too begins his ministry in preaching the word of God. I want to say to you, I realize many people got their opinion. I've never been sorry for those and anything that a preacher's ever preached to me, because it's in some way along the line, it's been a help to me. I could say there may be a lot of sorry preachers, there might be, but there's a lot of sorry other people in their professions as well, or positions on this earth. But I've always been helped by somebody preaching the Word of God to me. I've always been helped. Somebody said, what kind of preacher makes a preacher want to preach? The answer is two things, good preaching and bad preaching. But it helps you want to preach. I want to say a preaching servant here in the book of Acts, it was here the gospel that he preached, yes, but his duty was to serve. We find, as we are to today be reminded, we minister and labor in word and prayer. Today, people may want a lot of things from a preacher, but you don't find many people that just want a preacher to preach and be faithful to study in the Word of God and spend time in prayer. No, there's a great expectation, but here's one that God uses, and this is a one that's a willing servant, willing to share the gospel and to preach the gospel. I want to say there's many things it's hard to do in this life. Dr. Billy Martin used to say, and I've heard him say it many times, it's two things hard, or three things hard. He said it's hard to climb a ladder leaning towards you. It's hard to kiss a woman leaning from you. And it's hard for a preacher to preach a short sermon. But anyway, today, we find there are some things it's hard for a preacher. Some people think that the preacher gets up on Sunday morning, preaches a couple hours on Sunday, hour on Wednesday night, and he's done his job and he's got it made. Boy, if it's so easy, it wouldn't be so many preachers quitting. I want to tell you, it's not the easiest thing you'll ever do. You'll lay at night and you'll wonder, did I say and did I do all I was supposed to do? These that were there, did they hear? Did they understand? Did they receive? And all the things that go with it weighs on your mind. It never leaves you. And I pastored in 10 years. I was assistant for 16 years. And recently in this last year has been a different type of year. But I can say one thing. You just realize sometimes you don't realize how much a load you had until you just stop and breathe. And a lot of preachers never get that time. I remember Preacher Lemons used to say, he preached a Bible school and he said, if it was just a place on the road where I could just pull over and take a stop, if I could just rest for 5 minutes, because he's on the run. The former Pastor McClainsville, Preacher Kellum said this, and I don't know if everybody knows this. Preacher Kellum said, I told Preacher Lemons, he said, they'll run your legs off. A lot of wisdom in that, and people say, well, that's hard to say, but you don't know what it all involves. We find here's one that was just willing to go. Here's one, a servant of God by the name of Philip, that's willing to go to the desert and to share the gospel with this one Ethiopian. He's led by God. Yes, he's been sent by God. I want to say there's also within this responsibility a great privilege. Some years ago on visitation night, I was asked to go out to a lady's house. Says she's dying with cancer. And I remember the house as I walked in and as I left. And I thought, and I may mention, but a place where it was just a privilege just to share the gospel with her before she died, and later preach her funeral. I remember the house, and I had this later for another place, but I remember walking out of the house, and I'd never seen so much smoke-filled stain and so much on the walls and dust. I mean, I'm not exaggerating. nearly a half inch thick on the vents within the house. And I thought, how can a person live like, how could it, where, and the family not tending. And I thought to myself, but just willing to be able to, somebody to come share the gospel. Just somebody willing to go and tell someone about the Lord. There's some things that every preacher needs, and we can spend a lot of time, I realize, but you realize the preacher needs the power of God on him. This strength is not of his own. We find that every preacher needs the peace of God. You ever tried to push a rope? You ever tried to paddle upstream? You'll need the strength of God to preach the Word of God and to stand faithful. You'll need something else. A preacher will need the presence of God. You'll need someone to come alongside you and whisper sweet peace to your soul when there's times that nobody else can understand the trouble. Yes, they go through it in their life, but it's bare upon you. I'll tell you something funny. I don't know your pastor so well, but I've talked to other men. My family laughs at me about a lot of things. Just being dad, you get laughed at. And you get left out, too, if you hadn't learned that. But sometimes as a preacher, some preachers will feel everything that their people go through. My children laugh about it. But when your members have heart troubles, you hurt. They stump their toe, your toe hurts. I'm being a little funny, but some of us are like that. And it's something I believe it may be something the Lord gives you, or either you're off in your head, I don't know the difference. But anyway, many times, you'll need the presence of God to speak to you, comfort you along these times. And something else you're going to need, as a preacher, you're going to need the prayer of the saints. You're going to need people praying for you. We've often realized in times where you sense the Lord letting you know that people's praying for you. I studied yesterday a message. Studied all day. I don't get that opportunity a whole lot. The problem is, it just isn't the one I'm preaching now. But I knew somebody was praying for me. Somebody was praying. We need the prayer of the saints, and each preacher need this. You say, well, my preacher don't preach as good, and I know you don't say that. Sunday school teacher, he don't teach good, and you probably don't say that. But they'll teach and preach a whole lot better when you're praying for them. You'll notice that God's speaking to them in a special way to speak to you and to help you. And mighty churches will be those that understand the work of prayer in their home church. Here we find a preaching servant, one that was willing to go and to preach the word. And the scripture text this Ethiopian eunuch uses is that of Isaiah 53, his text verse. But he's preaching the word. I know there's all types of preaching and all types of preachers, and we're thankful for it, and you've seen a bunch of it yourself. But those is faithful to preach the word of God and to preach Christ unto us. We find here this one that as he preaches, he's holding forth the word of life. We could imagine in our mind's eyes and picture how at this place in the chariot they stood. Here was one with the word of God open and maybe unrolled, maybe at the time. But here is one that's reading of the prophet's report of our Savior Jesus Christ in Isaiah 53. Here we understand these are the words of life. And as I said, I had another sermon I studied, but today, and we live in this time, as bad as these times are and as bad as they're going to get, we still have the answer. And that's Christ and Christ alone. He's all we need today. And men need Christ like never before. They need the Lord. All that's going on, listen, what's going on in our country is not just against the evangelical, not just against the white man, not just against a conservative. The hatred that's being spewed out in our land today is against God. Amen. A direct attack upon God. We realize that we're in this battle. because we stand with the Lord. And there's been generations before us that have faced it far worse than we face today. And their country is in bad a shape or worse than ours. And yet God was faithful. And His word and His work and His will has carried on. I notice today that here as we preach, we understand. We've heard the gospel. We understand that which has been preached to us. And hear the words that Paul would write later, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised Him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the Scripture saith that whosoever believeth on Him shall not be ashamed. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. We're glad today in the work of Christ, in the work of Calvary done for the souls of men. The Bible says, how then shall they call on Him? Verse 14 of Romans 10. In whom they've not believed. And how shall they believe in Him who they've not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except it be sent? They be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah saith, Lord, who hath believed our report? The Bible says in verse 17, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We still today have a responsibility to preach the word of God. Thus saith the Lord. You say, what's going to make a difference? I want to tell you, today in which we live, many times our messages in churches today, we're encouraging the saints. We're encouraging the saints. We're encouraging the saints. Many of our messages in our day, today, we don't realize today there's the need today as well to share, deliver the gospel to men. We find today there's a need. Here we find a preaching servant. Be glad you've got a man to preach the word of God. That's not all the message today, but it's worth saying time and time again. But secondly, this morning, here's a pitiful sight. In verses 26 through 31, we read in these verses of this Ethiopian, this eunuch. That being itself may be pitiful, yes, but here's a man that's wandering. It portrays to us a wandering sinner. Here's one that's out in search and out with question and out with need in his life. How can I understand? How can I receive it? We find something that's important. Here's a wandering sinner. We could also say he's a wandering sinner. W-O-N as well. We find he had been worshiping. We read in these verses, he'd been worshiping God as a lost man. You say, can people worship God as a lost person? Oh, yeah, they can. But they're not worshiping Him in spirit and truth. I tell you, people today worship a lot of things. They really do. We was talking about animals a while ago, but I've never seen a day like this. I make somebody mad. I hope I don't make Miss Bonnie mad. But I know people that worship animals. They treat them like their children. That'll make somebody mad, won't it? People don't like that today, do they? But people worship a lot of things. I want to say to you today that we find here something pitiful. Here's a man worshiping God but wasn't born again. He'd never been saved. We also heard of a name mentioned, Billy Graham, and I remember reading some years ago, his words were that it's possible as much as 10% of the people in church, only 10% of the people in church know the Lord as Savior. Preaching all across our nation. And you wonder sometimes, but anyway, we find there's those that can worship God and not know Him in a personal way. They may go to church and they may be faithful in some things, but a pitiful sight is a man trying to worship God and not know Him. That's a pitiful thing. We see also he had no understanding of the Word of God. We'd also understand that he had a desire, though, to know more about it.
And that's us. We don't know everything. We'll probably never know everything, I believe, on this earth, no doubt. But there's something to be said about a desire for the Word of God. Here's a man. We find a pitiful sight. Here's one to want to know God. Just don't know how. Just want to know. You say, preacher, are there people like that today? I still believe there are. You talk to people about the Lord and everybody say, oh yeah. You know the Lord is Savior? Oh yeah. I'm a member of such and such church. My next question, who's the pastor? They can't tell you. I smile, but it's not all that funny, is it? Over and over, but yet there's still those. I remember years ago riding in a truck with a man driving, and a man probably nearly at least in his late 60s, if not in his early 70s. And I just shared John 3:16. He said, what's that? I've never heard it. And I thought, how in a country like this? Not here in John 3:16. Then we find of others, as I mentioned, of these that would just like to know. I've been asked to come to nursing homes. We've been asked to go to prison. We've been asked to go to the homes of people near their deathbed and share the gospel. And find many places in life. But there's people still that has an uncertainty, a question in their mind and in their heart. Do I know for sure that I'm saved? That when I die, I'll spend eternity in heaven? Or will I spend eternity in hell? People still have that question. I would say if there's one that would hear us today, if you have that question, you need to have it settled. You need to get settled. You need to make sure, for know for sure, that you have been born again, that when you die, you can go to heaven. We see here a pitiful sight. You say, well, it may be pitiful, people in this world that don't know for sure if they're saved. People in this world never been saved. You want me to tell you something that's even more pitiful than that? Is a person that can sit on a church pew week after week, year after year, for a big, large part of their life. And when they die, somebody has said, slip off a church pew into the devil's hell. That's a pitiful sight. And there's people in church that need to be born again. Awful quiet. You say you're talking about our church? No, I'm talking about any church. You talking about us? No, I'm talking about anybody. Everyone. And it's serious. And I know the importance is to be realized. We must be born again. We must be. It's not our membership. It's not many things that we think are to be religious in this life. But no, do you know for certain that you know the Lord is your personal Savior? Is there a relationship, not religion, a relationship with the Lord? Here's a pitiful sight. Thirdly, there's a precious story. Here, the story that's worn, but it's not worn out. A story that's old, yet it never grows old. A story that we could tell over again, as the songwriter would say, wonderful words of life. The songwriter, too, would say, I love to tell the story of how Jesus saved me. We understand this in history as his story. He reads in Isaiah 53, and for time's sake, I'll not turn this morning. But we read of a lamb that was sacrificed, and he was stricken for our transgression. His blood was shed for this world, for you and me, for whosoever. This story that is told is this good story, the good news, the gospel of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, how Christ has died for us, how he was buried for us, he rose again from the grave, that we too might have life eternal. As song was already sung this morning, this is good news, and yet this is simple. How simple can it be? Well, when the children of Israel were wandering through the wilderness, in their place of wandering, you know, their unbelief, their disobedience, and fiery serpents was sent among the camp. God was give instructions to lift up a brazen serpent and raise him up on a pole, that whosoever would look to that serpent and look to that pole, look up, would live. It's just as simple as looking up.
to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, saying, listen, I can't do it myself. I don't have the strength. I don't have the ability. I'm not good enough. I'll never reach that perfection. I'll never come to that place. But God, you can. Lord, you will save me if I trust in you and humbly believe and repent of my sin. Just so simple. Just so simple. It's a precious story, how precious it is. And oh, today many are misguided in direction and think, well, if I learn enough, if I am educated enough, if I achieve enough, if I go far enough in success, or if I'm wealthy enough and have enough in finances, oh no. Man can get to heaven without 10,000 things, but he cannot get to heaven without Jesus Christ and he alone as a personal Savior. Fourthly, this morning, there's a powerful sentence in verse 37. Notice, if you would, this chapter that we read in chapter 8 and verse 37, a powerful sentence, he says, and Philip said, if thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. I believe that Christ is the Son of God. Jesus is called in the Bible the Son. He's called the Son of God, the Son of the living God, the only begotten Son, the Son of the Father. He's called by the Father, my Son. He's titled the Son of Man, the Son of the Highest, and the Son of the Blessed. God the Father said in Matthew chapter 17, this is my beloved Son. Jesus said, I am the Son of God. Gabriel announced, this is the Son of God. John the Baptist would say, this is the Son of God. John would say, the Christ, the Son of God. Paul said, he is the Son of God. The disciples, Nathanael said, thou art the Son of God. Martha would say, Christ, the Son of God. The centurion would stand by there and say, by his, at the crucifixion, at the cross, and say, truly, this was the Son of God. Mark chapter 3, the unclean spirit would speak out and say, thou art the Son of God. The legions would cry, thou Son of the Most High God. This eunuch said in his words, he said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. You say, why the emphasis today? Because many false religions of our day and many that believe in their minds are darkened because they believe not that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. He is God. Today there's a problem with many in false teaching with that concept that he is God in the flesh, the very Son of God. And I believe, as John would say, and we read in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And I could say along with this, I believe he is who he says he is. Most of us, we say we don't know everything. We don't really know a lot. We're babes in Christ. The more we read and understand of the Word of God, we're really glad to know that he is who he says he is. He is the true and living God. All we could go with his names and all we could go all about God, but Christ in the flesh, but he is who he says he is. And I believe God. We find today he's the Christ. That Greek form of this Hebrew name is that of Messiah, the promised one. The title which connects him to the Old Testament in foreview of the coming prophet, priest, and king. He's all that he says he is and he's more, but he is the Son of God. And as I said today, as people in our day have a problem with God, they have a problem with Jesus. I tell you, Jesus ought to be the word that is so sweetly, the name so sweetly, that of Jesus. Amen. Sweetest name I know. Yeah. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. There's no other name given among men whereby we must be saved. That is the name of Jesus. The Bible tells us that if we pray in Jesus' name, and I'm not afraid, nor do we be ashamed of the name Jesus. A name above every name, that name Jesus. We see again, there's some things in these verses that we read, a powerful sentence. He said, I believe Jesus is the Son of God. Today, we that know the Lord, we know Him as Savior. We know Jesus as He is. We know He's our Alpha and Omega. He's our beginning, our end. He's our all in all. He's the Almighty. He's the one that helps us, dear to us in time of need. There's no other friend like friend Jesus. But here's fifthly this morning, I realized my time, and Dad let me know what time you let out. He said, but now other preachers coming, they might preach a little longer. But I can't do that today. But anyway, a lot of times I can. I'll tell the truth. But I won't today. Here's a pretty scene. I don't know about you, but I like scenery. It's nothing to do with the message. We got married, Carol and I did, and we went off for 2 weeks, and we tried to get as much in as we could. I told her, I said, we never get to do this again. One of the first places we went to Ashbury, it was in December the 11th, 93. There was a freezing storm. The temperature in Ashbury was either 20 below zero. The nicest place to stay in, I said Ashbury, it was Asheville, the nicest place to stay you could find. Water pipes was frozen. Saturday night, we still got up and went to church Sunday morning to Trinity Baptist Church at the time. We went up and got to church, but anyway, I told that story briefly to tell you this. We got back from our honeymoon, and Carolyn said, Jeff, look at all these pictures you took. Wasn't a picture of us at all. It was pictures of the scenery, all the mountains and all the barns. I like a pretty scene. I think things ought to look the best they can. That's just how I feel. We'll do the best we can. But anyway, in the message today, a pretty scene. Verse 38, notice it said, and he commanded the chariot to stand still, and they went both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and baptized him. Again, this is baptism, but we understand that here this believer is identifying himself with Christ. He's obeying the Lord, following the Lord in believer's baptism. And we know this is the picture of death, burial, resurrection of Jesus Christ. And this portrays that. It's a pretty scene. I don't tell you it's a wonderful thing to see and know the for others to trust the Lord. And it's good to see folks baptized to follow the Lord. We could spend a lot of time there, but there's three words I use, and I probably share this a lot, but the word is immersion. That word means going into the water. There's another word, submersion. That means going under the water. And there's another word, immersion, and that's coming out of the water. We find these three words pictures to us the death burial of Jesus Christ, following the Lord. And I also would say this follows salvation. How many in Catholicism and other false beliefs, and even some Protestants still today, they can tell you, well, I was baptized when I was a baby. That don't work, does it? No. Baptism follows salvation. Right. We follow the Lord, yes, but we as believers, baptism follows salvation. We do this as an act of obedience to the Lord, to identify ourselves with Christ, and that's a pretty scene. It's a wonderful thing. But here, lastly this morning in the message, there's a personal satisfaction. Look in verse 39 again, he said, and when they were come up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord called away Philip, that the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. Back up in verse 8, I believe it is, the Bible says, and there was great joy in that city. After the preaching of the word and those that believed in Christ, it brought joy to their lives, not only for a city, but for a soul. And how wonderful. What about the testimony of this believer already? This Ethiopian gave a testimony of his joy in the Lord. Something I pray that we'll never get over. It's what the Lord's done for us when He saved us. Something that is blessed to us of all the things that's happened in my life, nothing measures up or compares to when the day the Lord saved me. Amen. I can remember when all of my children were born.
I can remember when their eyes opened first, and some of them in different ways they looked around, or the voices they made and things they did. I remember the day I got married. But I can remember the day the Lord saved me, just a six-year-old boy. I'm thankful for what the Lord has done. There's personal satisfaction. This is something a lost man don't have. And you wonder why today, when folks can be so mean and so vile, there's no joy and there's no peace. And there's no true love in their heart. There couldn't be. Some would say they really don't know any better because they don't know Jesus Christ. You realize today it's what we're facing. Today there's many that need to be born again. The songwriter has said only Jesus can satisfy your soul. Today, this morning, last night, and again tonight, would you say that if I was to lay down my head, at night I can go to bed with rest in my heart and mind to know I know Jesus is my Savior? And when you wake the next day, could you wake again with that same purpose and knowledge in your heart? I know Jesus. I'm going to ask you this morning, would you just stand quietly among the sanctuary this morning with heads bowed and with eyes closed? Do you really know and have assurance this morning of Christ as your Lord and Savior, and the joy and the peace that comes in your heart and in your life and in your mind of what He's done for you? I realize this is no doubt been preached time and time and time again. It is our responsibility to be faithful. We don't know who may be in attendance. We don't know the heart, but I promise you, you know your heart and God knows your heart. God knows. If there's a need to come this day, this altar's open. We'll be glad to take the Bible and pray with you and share with you how you too can know. Glad to show you through the Word of God how you can know for certain. As our musicians begin, our song leader comes. If you need to come this day, you come.
Trust and obey. Mentioned at the beginning of the service, Brother David is being deployed again. You're still a lieutenant colonel.
Yes, sir.
Still a lieutenant colonel, but being deployed. back over to Afghanistan. This is, I know it's the military, but it's going to be operating under the State Department, I assume, what you shared with me. And the Afghans that have been helpful to us for 20 years, maybe you got brought over to the state, and Brother David's part of me, part of that. He may be gone 2 months, maybe gone even a year, as he mentioned. I don't know a lot about going on over there. He gets, of course, much more information with the military than I ever would, but it's a lot like the Wild West over there right now, folks. And there's not really any area you call a behind the lines, I guess, anymore. That's gone. So I've always prayed as our fellows here have been going overseas through the year. But just impress the Lord today to pray, especially for David this time. Of course, Sally, too, as she holds down the home front for David while he's gone. But would you join us in prayer real quickly? Our Father, once again, we understand that the world in which we live in is a world that Satan is the god of. We have watched our country battle for 20 years in an area. Now, as our soldiers are coming home, Lord, we pray first that they would be honored as warriors of our nation and given honor that's due them and respect that's due them as they serve their country. We pray also for those who have lift their hands to help us during that time of warfare. We pray, Lord, that many we know whose life now is in danger would be safely brought to our states and be able to have a life here, Lord, that might be peaceable for them. I pray for David, Lord. I pray you'd hedge him about. Lord, I believe I've seen in the Word of God where you hedged about your servant Job. I believe you can hedge about David, Lord. Protect him during his time. Keep him safe. Protect him. Draw him close to you during his time. Be with Kelly as she's here with responsibilities of the home front. Bless now above all, Lord. Jesus, we thank you in Jesus' precious name and ask your blessings. In his name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You want to speak to Brother David? Do something. This is the last Sunday he'll be with us. He'll be on the trip next Sunday. And then, of course, Brother Jeff, thank you for that message. What a blessing that was to me personally and that to others as well. Good day. God bless you. See you tonight, Lord willing.